ala rasulihi Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. So respected brothers and elders, alhamdulillah, we've commenced the month of Ramadan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us in this momentous month. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our worship. May Allah accept our fasting. May Allah accept our charity, our prayers, our supplication. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to enter the blessed month of Ramadan with profound blessings and anticipation. And may Allah allow us to reach the conclusion of the month of Ramadan in a state that we are forgiven and we are blessed. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. So as we know, the Salatul Taraweeh, it consists of recitation of the Holy Qur'an. And the Holy Qur'an is no ordinary book. Rather, the Holy Qur'an is a book that was revealed by our Creator and our Sustainer, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have numerous books. You walk into Indigo or Chapters, or you go to Amazon, and you find book after book, compilation after compilation, volumes after volumes. But all of those books that we have access to, they are authored by human beings. They are authored by human beings who have limits in terms of their intellect, their reasoning, and their foresight. The book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran al-Kareem, is authored by the Creator of humans. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being the author, has no deficiency like the human, has no limits like the human. Rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-Qadir, He is ever-powerful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-Basir, He has the insight to everything, He has the wisdom to everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-Hakim, He is the all-wise, so His wisdom has no limits. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator and the maker, and therefore He knows what is best for humanity. In Aqidatu Tahawiyya, the very famous manual for Islamic creed, the author writes, no matter what a human being strives to achieve, when the human being achieves a certain status or a certain skill set or an educational level, it requires some effort, some stamina, and some time. So for example, a doctor, an engineer, an IT professional, a construction worker, these individuals, they don't get this title until they have gone through some effort, some sacrifice, some time, and some duration of their life. A child is not born with the title engineer or an IT specialist or a construction worker. It's after this person has gone through some effort and some time spent in that field and experience or even licensed in that field, then only a person is given the designation of being a doctor or an engineer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He did not require any time to become the creator. He was always the creator. He is always the creator. One of the verses we see in the Holy Quran that is often repeated is Huwa al-awwal wal-akhir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the first of the first. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the last of the last. Meaning there's nothing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's nothing after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَيْسَ قَبْلَهُ شَيْءٍ وَلَيْسَ بَعْدَهُ شَيْءٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is everything. There's a verse in the Holy Quran that is often repeated once again. كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the ability to simply say كُنْ, be, and it is. Whereas the engineer, the doctor, the professor, they can't just formulate something by simply saying it. They have to put it together, they have to master it, they have to spend years before they put something into formalization. So, who is the author of the Quran? It is a perfect being, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the opening verses of the Holy Quran, He tells us and he indicates to us that we are so ignorant that we don't even know the meaning of Alif Lam Mim. You ask any scholar, any mufassir, any commentator of the Quran, any sahabi, you ask even the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what's the meaning of Alif Lam Mim? Allahu a'lamu bi muradihi bidhalik. Every mufassir, every commentator has written, Allahu a'lamu bi muradihi bidhalik. Only Allah knows the meaning of what is intended by Alif Lam Mim. And most of the chapters of the Holy Quran, they begin with what we call huruful muqatta'at. These letters that commence the surah. They are letters that seem to be out of place. Alif Lam Mim. Yes. There's no doubt that some scholars have speculated, they have made assumptions, they have made some suggestions that Alif can refer to Allah because Allah starts with Alif. And Lam refers to Jibreel because Jibreel is the angel which was appointed to bring down the Holy Quran. So in Jibreel, the end of Jibreel, the word Jibreel has the letter Lam. And then Mim refers to Muhammad, and this is sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is the chain of revelation from Allah to Jibreel, from Jibreel to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So this is a speculation, this is an assumption. Some scholars have suggested that this is perhaps the meaning, but the reality is neither the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam conveyed to us the meaning of Alif Lam Mim, nor Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our creator, tells us about the meaning in the Holy Quran. And one reason for this is Allah is telling us, I'm giving you a book, but you can only attain knowledge from this book if you become ignorant before this book. If the student walks into the class of the professor with all this ego and arrogance that I know it all, that I know more than the professor, I've done the research, I've already read the book and the textbook, then this person won't learn much from the professor. Why? Because this individual believes that this person is already equipped and has the knowledge. Who is the best learner? The best learner is the one that says, I don't know, I will learn from another. So we don't know, Allah tells us, I'm telling you, you don't know, Alif Lam Mim. That you can't even explain what's the meaning of three letters put together, Alif Lam Mim. So Allah is telling us, you better consider yourself ignorant, and that's how you will be guided. That's how you will be given the knowledge. So in order for us to access the knowledge that is in the Quran, we have to surrender to our Creator that He guides us. He has the complete knowledge. His knowledge is comprehensive, and our knowledge is limited. So we have to be students of the Quran. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, the Prophet Moses, someone asked him a question in his majlis, in his gathering. Who has the most knowledge? Who has the most knowledge? So Musa alayhi salatu wasalam reflected for a moment and he responded by saying, Ana. He said, I have the most knowledge. And the commentators in this narration that is reported in the books of hadith, they have mentioned that he was truthful in his statement. That from amongst all the human beings, the man who had the most knowledge during his time was the Prophet Moses, was Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. But Allah taught him a lesson. Allah said, go to such and such a place, here's the navigation, here's the map for you. It's in Surah Al-Kahf, the whole incident and the event, the story. And Allah said, go find this individual whose name is Khadr. And once you meet him, you'll find out that he has some knowledge that you do not have. And that was the knowledge of Taqwiniyat. Why things happen in the way they happen. Sometimes we question as human beings that an accident happened. Allah protect each and every one of us. A child passes away. So we question that this was an innocent child. What fault was there for this child that this child's life was cut short? And we object, we question. So only Allah knows what's best, and Allah through His wisdom has given death to this child for maybe something that we don't realize, we don't know. But we surrender to that. That's why when Ibrahim, the son of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, had passed away, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that I do not object on the decree of the Almighty. لِلَّهِ مَا أَعْطَى وَلِلَّهِ مَا أَخَذْ. What Allah has given, He has taken away. Allah is the one that's given the child to me, and Allah has taken it away. Today a verse was recited that whenever any musibah, any difficulty comes upon the believer, what do they say? Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. We belong to Allah, and to Him shall we return. So Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he finally, after going through hurdles and difficulties and challenges, he meets up with Khadr, with this great personality. Some scholars say he was a prophet, other scholars say no, he was not a prophet. But nevertheless, he was given knowledge by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of the taqweeniyat, of the knowledge of why things happen the way they happen. And even a prophet is not given this knowledge. So this was a lesson for Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, that we need to be humble. Even though the Prophet Moses had the most knowledge at that time during his era, yet his response was arrogant. So what did he learn from this entire journey? Is that there are people who have a different type of knowledge. I may be selected as a prophet, but Allah gives knowledge to whomsoever He wills. And knowledge is so vast. It's so vast that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declares in the Quran, وَمَا أُوتِيتُم مِّنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا وَمَا أُوتِيتُم مِّنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. Allah says, you have only been given a speck of knowledge. And scholars, they describe this knowledge as an ocean. And some people take a cup of that water from the ocean, some people take a spoon of that water, and some people only take a droplet of that water. So the Quran is profound knowledge. The Quran is a manual for our life, for us to succeed in our life here, as well as in the everlasting life of the hereafter. And we can only benefit from the Qur'an if we become students of the Qur'an, if we constantly learn from the Qur'an. One of my teachers, who's spent his entire life in tafsir of the Holy Qur'an, in the commentary of the Qur'an, he says every single day he learns something new about the Qur'an. And any tafsir you talk about, tafsir al-Qurtubi, tafsir Ibn Kathir, Tafsir Al-Kabir or Al-Razi. These are great manuals of tafsir. He's almost memorized these tafasir, these various books of tafsir and commentary of the Holy Quran. Yet he is learning every single day something from the Quran. So the Quran is vast. It's a knowledge. So one of the duties we have, mashallah, in Salatul Taraweeh, we stood, we heard the verses of the Holy Quran. This is a great achievement. And every word that we hear, we are getting blessings. Every word that we recite, we are getting rewards. Our status is being elevated. Allah is forgiving our sin. And this is the month of the Quran. The month of Ramadan is the month of the Quran. So this is very beneficial to recite or hear the Quran. But the next step is that we have to also ponder and reflect and take from the knowledge of the Holy Quran. And I'll conclude with a profound verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنِ. Do they not ponder over the Qur'an? Do they not reflect on the meaning of the Qur'an? One of the signs of the Day of Judgment is people will recite the Qur'an and they'll be very articulate at reciting the Qur'an. But the Prophet ﷺ says in this report, in this narration, that it will not pass their throats. The Qur'an will not pass their throats. What is the Prophet ﷺ saying? Is that they will articulate it with their mouths, with their tongue, with all the rules and regulations of articulation, tajweed and pronunciation, again, which is very important. However, it will not pass their throats, meaning that it will not enter their heart. It will not be a means and a source for their guidance. It will not be a source for their actions and transformation. So in this blessed month of Ramadan, let us take daily moments to also reflect upon the message of the Quran. And whatever we learn from the Quran, let us implement it. Let us propagate it. Let us share it with others. And inshallah, we will see the Quran as a manual for ourselves. We will see it as a solution to our problems. We will see it as a guidance to every failure of ours as a human nation. And again, by adopting and accessing this beautiful Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will preserve us, He will protect us, and He will give us the best of this life and the hereafter. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said before he passed away, I leave behind two things. Kitabullah. The first thing is the book of Allah. And the second is my teachings, which is basically expansion of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has declared in the Holy Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspire us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to be attached to the Quran. Allah make this month for us a means of connecting with the message of the Quran. Allah transform our lives with the Quran. Allah provide relief from all our difficulties through the nur and the blessing of the Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the best in this world and the hereafter. رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ وَتُبْ عَلَيْنَا مَوْلَانَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ وَصَلَى اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَلَى خَيْرِ خَلْقِهِ مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ أَجْمَعِينَ بِرَحْمَتِكَ يَا رَحْمَنُ الرَّحِيمُ